What is generative AI?
Generative AI is the latest generation of AI. We've had a lot of types of AI since the 1950s. This is the most recent kind, and it's basically created by scraping all the data people can find on the internet and creating this huge massive database of over a trillion data points. And then having the AI deep learning model look for the relationships between all these different terms and phrases and sentences. And so it can see, and it basically creates this map of all the patterns and the weights it gives to different connections. And it then uses that as sort of a complex autocomplete that when then the human prompts it with a question, it's basically trying to predict what you want to hear.
How has generative AI already impacted courts and the legal field?
It's a lot of different types of applications. It's things like contract review, legal research, and so on, but also probably helping with drafting documents, including documents filed with courts. So one of the big concerns is if documents are filed with courts that contain fake citations. These large language models are basically instructed not to regurgitate what they've already read, but to come up with something novel and new. And because of that, they will often create a citation to something that doesn't exist, that looks very realistic, but they have created it out of whole cloth. And so we've seen about a dozen examples of lawyers filing with courts a brief or a motion that includes fake citations. And so that's a big concern because that's now potentially now sort of polluting our judicial database with fake information. But on the other hand, it's helping people research better, write better. Pro se litigants, I talked to a judge a few weeks ago, says the first time seeing these great briefs from pro se litigants because the AI is helping them write the brief. So we're going to get better quality writing, but the risk of some fake information interspersed within it.
How can courts use AI to their benefit?
A number of courts are, for example, using it with chatbots to basically create a voice that you can call into 24/7 if you have a question for the court, if you're a juror, if you're a litigant, if you just have a question about, want to maybe file a case. And so many courts have now instituting these chatbots to try to reduce the load on their human personnel and allow their human personnel to deal with the more complex questions and have the simple, straightforward ones dealt with by a chatbot. So that's one way courts can do it. A lot of clerk's offices around the country are using this to help automated filing and actually getting much more accurate dockets where documents are filed much more accurately than they are in some of the traditional way of humans doing this. Some courts are starting to use this to help pro se litigants and other unrepresentative litigants perhaps fill up forms to be able to file a case and have that sort of first steps help them to do that in the correct way. And that saves everybody time, both the court and the litigants and the other side. So there's a lot of sort of creative ways people are using this. You can use it for hiring. You can use it for all kinds of administrative things, tracking, you know, how many jurors do you bring in is it the right amount? There's just sort of unlimited opportunities for creativity in using this powerful technology.
What are the challenges of AI?
I think there's sort of three major ones. The first one is what we already discussed of the fake citations, sometimes called hallucinations. We know these systems will hallucinate. Something like maybe 20% of the citations are false. So this is going to happen fairly regularly. Over time, these machines should get better, but maybe knock down to zero at any point in the near future. So that's a huge issue. The accuracy, are they actually having correct citations? And I should say, along with that, there's the issue of they don't really understand what they're saying. They are looking for the relationships between words and phrases, but they don't understand the true meaning of it. In some ways, they're sort of like a parrot in that sense, is that they can say back things very clearly, very interestingly, but they don't necessarily understand it. So sometimes they may miss important parts of an issue as well, that if a judge or a lawyer is using it for, if the judge or lawyer doesn't sort of second guess and sort of check it, there may be an important something missing in that argument that the lawyer judge would know is missing. So that's one thing, the accuracy of the information. A second is bias. These systems are trained on human data, Unfortunately, our history of human data is filled with all kinds of biases and stereotypes, and that data gets replicated and even sometimes enhanced in the AI system. It basically brings it out, and it looks like it's an objective machine that's doing this. It shouldn't have any reason to be biased, but because it's basing its recommendations or its findings on human data, it's going to replicate some of those biases we have. Then the third thing is confidentiality. If you put in data into these the public models, they can data can get back into the data set and then be accessible possibly to other people. So any type of personal information or any case-specific information, you should not put it into these models unless you have what's called an enterprise system, which is detached from the public product.
How have other states leveraged AI?
I'm on the Supreme Court committee here in Arizona, and we just had a presentation at our meeting a couple of weeks ago on the chatbots that our court here in Arizona is using and how it's helping the clerk's office deal with a huge influx of people calling in with questions and so on, and being able to sort of take all the sort of simple and direct ones and answer it in an acceptable way with the chatbot without putting more demand on human resources, and then allowing the human workers to deal with the more complex and interesting questions and more sort of unique questions. Even just security for logging into your computer, people are using facial recognition with AI. So, different states are trying different things, trying to better improve the jury pool by having better data and more complete data for calling jurors is another thing some states are doing. Helping just with information when you come to the courthouse with various types of apps run by AI and so on to tell jurors, to tell litigants, what room are you in? When do you need to be there? To check in so that the clerk or whoever knows that the jurors arrived or the litigants have arrived. So there's a lot of different ways that people are experimenting, but there's a lot of learning, I think, that can be done from what different states are doing.
What should the public know about AI?
It's going to be a permanent part of our lives from now on. We'll never have another day where AI plays such a small role as it is today. It's only going to get bigger day by day by day. So it's something we all have to get used to. We all have to become familiar with. It's affecting every single type of profession and occupation and business. It's going to have all kinds of benefits, but it's definitely going to have some downsides and concerns and risks as well. And it's a matter of being a sophisticated user of this technology to understand the risks and be able to use it in a safe and beneficial way. It's not something that's going to be just a flash in the pan. It's just going to become more and more profound as we go forward.
The Judicial Council recently announced next steps on use of generative AI in California courts, including launching a task force, working with committees on developing guidance, and providing education for staff. What other steps should the council consider?
One thing is to consider, what apps do you want your staff to use? So there's more and more of these AI tools and apps coming out basically every week. Are there ones that you go through some kind of testing or some kind of validation to make them comfortable to use in your courtroom? And you give that kind of guidance to your staff? Or is it just sort of anything goes? I think a lot of states have decided to sort of have some confirmed apps that they've gone through their IT department, have verified that they are safe or not safe. And so they're having sort of recommended list of the types of tools that employees should use. There's issues of making sure they, the training to that they don't put confidential case information or employee information into these public chatbots or public chats. That's another very important part of it. There's the whole issue of should judges and their clerks and staff lawyers be using this to help write and research opinions? We're starting to see some courts are doing that, but not, making the final decision is still the human judge, but what's the appropriate role of that? And then I think there's just a huge opportunity to help the people who aren't being represented in our court system, who do have legitimate legal claims, to help assist them to be able to use the court system in a more easy way by various types of AI programs that can help them file and fill out documents, file documents and so on. I think there's a lot of work that can be done in that space by courts to really, legitimize themselves as a true public place to decide these kind of disputes. The public court should be the place that people go, and to make it easier for them to do it, because so many people can't afford it now, where they think they have to hire a lawyer and they can't afford that. So I think there's a lot of opportunity there to help the people who aren't currently being able to benefit from our court systems from doing so. And I think that will just help to improve the reputation and the credibility of our court systems.
Why should we take steps towards studying AI now?
I think we're in a really unique time in human history where this very powerful technology is suddenly becoming relevant and important for almost everything we do, including what courts are doing. And so it's really important to take advantage of this opportunity, but also to guard against the concerns and risks that it can create. And, we'll look back 10 years from now and see this as, I think, a transformative time period in our history, for the courts, for society, for every industry generally. And how we handle this transition is going to be a big challenge. And it's exciting to be, that we're all part of that at this time, but it's something that has to be done carefully, but with some optimism that this can really make things better.